And now, our Random Minds feature presentation.
Given the evolution of the characters of Stormer and RC in the past decade and a half that you know of, do you feel that they are credit to the characters you've originally voiced?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, as we change as humans, you know, we evolve, we keep evolving, that the characters of Stormer and RC have certainly evolved also. So, yeah, I mean, I think they're honest to the basic personality when I did them, but I think they've certainly gone into evolved.
Yeah.
Let's put it that way.
Did we have to let them detonate 3/4 of the ship?
Seeing as how they would have detonated 4/4, I think it was a good choice.
But now how are we going to get there at this point?
And they basically took the audience conspiracy of that one episode where you and Kathy and Blore's characters joined together away from the other bands.
Yeah.
Yeah, because in the IDW comics, they were in a relationship.
Well, and also, you know, Stormer kind of was the good misfit.
Yep. The only reason I could actually sit through an actual episode of Gem and the Hologram.
All right.
I thought that the other misfits were really petty, and it was really hard for me to watch.
You don't care about anything I say. You wanted us to be serious.
What?
Yeah. Oh, look at that.
Yeah.
Is that the original?
Yeah. I got these from the video rental part of my grocery store back in the early 2000s when they were getting rid of them.
That's very cool.
Yeah. And this is the one where Michael Horton played your brother.
Yes, Michael Horton. I see him on Facebook with his bulldog a lot.
I love the songs.
She's too much of a rebel, she'll land you in his due. She's a bad influence, bad influence, a bad influence on you.
That's terrific.
That was the only song that I know of the Misfits and the Holograms sing. Yeah.
Boy, you know, the music was really great, I thought.
Although it was a little too specialized, the lyrics, to ever be believable as real records.
Don't look now, here comes trouble. Trouble. Here comes trouble heading my way. Trouble. Once again, here comes trouble. Trouble. Turning my blue skies to gray. Trouble.
Yeah, that's true. I agree with you.
But, you know, they're making it so that people can actually have blue hair now.
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, every time I see an African-American girl with blue hair, I always think of Shayna.
Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah, totally.
And now, rock along with today's music video.
Question 7. Are there times when people, when you're out on the street and who've not ever, you know, seen your face before, feel like they've recognized your voice from the cartoons that they've watched?
Yeah, that has happened to me, where people have occasionally walked up to me and said, do you do cartoon voices? And I go, yeah, that has happened. Not a lot, but.
Yeah, you'd have to have trained ears for that.
Yeah, I'll say.
Otherwise, not a lot of people would be able to realize that it wasn't Paul Frees who was in the Aesop and Son and Fractured Fairy Tales part of Rocky and Bullwinkle, but Doss Butler.
Yeah, exactly. I get more people really, which is kind of funny, recognizing me from Friday the 13th, part 7.
No!
I saw a couple of clips from that, and that was a very interesting hairstyle, very reminiscent of the.
Yeah, I call it my Farrah Fawcett hair.
Oh, that's a very sad. Her death date is my birthday.
Oh, honey, I'm sorry.
Well, since I talked about Paul Frees and Doss Butler, were you ever a fan of Rocky and Bullwinkle? I asked this of all the voice actors I've interviewed, but I didn't ask Michael that, and it didn't occur to me then.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. That was like, you know, the epitome of the height of when animation was going to go crazy. Do you know what I mean?
Of course.
And it was just so pure.
That sounds like a lady in distress.
No.
Gee, didn't you ever read the Hero's Handbook?
I can never get past the picture of General MacArthur on the cover.
Well, chapter 2 says we should always help ladies in distress.
Paul Frees, you know, it's interesting because I was Poppy the Pillsbury Dough Girl to his Dough Boy.
Oh. Hi, I'm Poppy the Pillsbury Dough Girl.
Nothing says love it like my chocolate chip cookies. Woo-hoo!
Exactly. Yeah, I worked with Paul Frees quite a bit.
What was he like? Because I've heard that he was kind of an abrasive person.
He was always great to me. He was just great.
And he was one of the first few to ever like do his voiceover lines from off location, from his house.
Yeah, that's true, isn't it? Now everybody's doing them from their house.
One of the things I really love about the interviews that I've done in the past year or so is I've learned so much from it. Everything from Michael Bell being in Star Wars to the family history of Greg Berger and how his family came from where my family came from. And all the stuff that Brian Cummings told me about promo and voice acting.
Yeah.
All of it just bolsters my love of all of it. And it's magic. Voice acting is the purest kind of magic there is.
Oh, it really is.
Yeah.
And very good at it.
And it's the ultimate equalizer. I mean, when Michael Bell was in Morning Star, it was a completely different type of Hollywood prism. You had to look the part. I mean, you had to be Tony Geary to be Luke Spencer. Different show, but with voice acting, it all comes down to whether your voice oscillates in the right way and whether it actually fits with the character. Like, for instance,
Cup and Hot Rod just bought it. I can't deal with it now. Face it, Magnus. The Decepticons are going to dog us until they see us dead. And that's exactly what they're going to see. Prepare for emergency separation. That's too dangerous. What choice do we have?
Boy, that's that's terrific.
I'm a huge Robert Stack fan. I have his autograph downstairs.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, and I loved...
Get to work with Judd Nelson. I did a scene with Judd.
I was afraid you'd be trapped outside the city.
I wasn't worried for a microsecond.
Acting is all about responding to what the other person is saying.
Then you probably didn't understand the situation.
That's when it's great, when you have somebody to play with.
Transformers the movie is one of the best movies ever made, and
isn't that
any of the Michael Bay ones come close is Dark of the Moon.
I was able to revisit the movie, I don't know, quite a few months ago, and boy, to me it still held up.
Yeah,
you know, it still held up.
What I really love about voice acting also is like there's voiceover circles. Beak would have the same voice actors for their projects, and Hanna-Barbera especially. That is definitely one of the most circled cast of voice actors ever.
Yeah, you know, it was great that, because I was able to break into Hanna-Barbera. It is true, you know, I'd always work basically with most of the same people. Yeah, you know, when I first started out in voiceover acting, there was, you know, I mean, it was Michael Bell and Frank Welker and Don Messick and
Ben Stevenson.
Yeah, Julie Dees and BJ Ward. And then it got bigger and bigger and bigger. And, you know, Wally Burr, who directed me in Transformers and
Jim and the Holograms? That's what did G.I. Joe, but I think you were only in like maybe a couple of episodes.
Yeah, I was only in a few of those episodes, but you know, he would basically use the same people over and over and over.
And he would test their patience with how long the day would be. I've heard that from a lot of people.
Yeah. And Hasbro, you know, they kept casting me and stuff, and it was great. I loved it.
It's one of the smartest things that Hassenfield Brothers has ever done.
Yeah, I'll say. Yeah. You know, and there's not really, there's a lot more work now for women than there was when it first started out. And you see a lot more women doing even car commercials, and many, many animated shows now are for women. And so that's great.
And also there's the thing that you and June Foray and Nancy Cartwright and Tara Strong do is they cast women for little boys, you know, as opposed to what Doss Butler used to do back in the days of Rocky and Bullwinkle. Oh, hi, Pop. This isn't lunch. So I figured, candy, is it? Yeah, I was going to give it to my girl for Valentine's. Instead, you gave it to your stomach. She doesn't like me anymore. She's got a crush on Butch Croesus.
Well, I should think you should be heartbroken.
I was, for about 10 minutes.
Junior, you have just displayed one of my best adages, to wit, time heals all wounds.
Charles Ruggles. Right.
You are really good. Have you done this for Michael and the other people you've interviewed?
I have quite a few of my voices in. But I think that Brian summed it up best when he said that I'm a good mimic.
Yeah, you're a wonderful mimic.
I used to own your books. My great uncle in California sent them to me. I don't have them anymore because the format of, you know, of audition and everything has changed. I didn't know if it was still viable to this. It wasn't, you know, a personal thing that I got rid of them. I wish I still had. I'm not sorry. I have Asperger's. That's part of why my cerebral gears move so fast, but it affects me with a stutter that I really despise. It doesn't happen when I'm doing the quotes.
Right. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah. It's
Asperger people are unbelievably intelligent. So.
Yeah. And we're like planet Pluto. We're declassified. Yeah. It's just plain old autism now.
Yeah. Were you diagnosed as a kid?
My parents saw that there was something off, but back then, I was actually born 2 months before Transformers the movie's release.
Right.
So back in those days, people didn't really talk about it, but my parents, they had the foresight, and it wasn't until like I was 14 that I got evaluated, but I got the help that I needed. I've got my, you know, filter. I've got my social cues improving, and I'm going into a field where I'm not going to need to talk that much except to, you know, swear in the witness.
Oh, what are you doing?
I'll show you. I'm sure you've given a deposition before.
Oh my gosh, that's fantastic.
I'm close to the end.
How long did it take you to learn that?
More than I really wish to, you know, say. Because the program that I was in, they were dismantling it, and it took a lot longer. Yeah. It's not something I'm really proud of, how long I've been there. But the point is, I'm getting close. But no matter how much I do, I hope to God John Machida never has to give a deposition in St. Louis. Exactly. I didn't even told him that myself. Oh, that's yeah.
Fun. Congratulations. I think that's fabulous.
Yeah, it's a profession that's sort of like an inverse of what we were talking about with voice actors, how it used to be dominated a lot by men. Female stenographers were mostly the norm.
Yeah.
So that's kind of a interesting little parallel.
That is so cool. I'm so glad you're doing that.
Yeah, but I haven't given up on my dream of becoming a voiceover artist.
Okay, don't.
I just, I need something to fall back on because like you said, voice acting has exploded. And
you know, it really has. It's, you know, I was very lucky to get into directing when I did, because a lot of my friends, you know, the different echelon of ages, you know, Tara is kind of Tara Strong, that group of Cassusi, they're like right behind me. And Jennifer Darling, myself, Susan Silo, you know, June Foray was ahead of me, you know, and then along came people like myself and
Patricia
now
Paris, Noel.
Yeah, yeah, and there are people behind Kath and behind Tara and behind Gray.
Griffin, Delisa.
Gray Griffin, you know, that are now coming up. So, I mean, life goes on and newbies come into the industry all the time.
There's one that I can think of whose mother you used to work with, Pat Music's daughter, Mae Whitman.
How about that? Pat Music is one of my dearest, dearest friends.
Yeah. And she was Snappy Smurfling.
Yeah, she sure was. And, you know, and Mae is, you know, she's a star. She's a TV star.
Yeah, and I love the way she voiced Tinkerbell. The mythos stories I talked about, basically I've created a multiverse of Peter Pan, sort of. And it takes place in our world. It's kind of hard to explain. The whole family, the Jones family, they're obsessed with Peter Pan, and for good reason. They're actually descended from Fae and Never Tribe royalty.
Wow.
Yeah. I call them the Never Tribe. I don't call them Indians.
Have you for sure copyrighted that and gotten that out to people?
No, I've got my mythos stuff on my blog. Not a lot of people have seen it because mainly it's really hard to understand because the multiverse I talk about, it's what I call the Great Myriad. It's a wormhole from our universe and a parallel dimension called the Neverscape, and all the Neverlands that you can think of, except for the Disneyverse, and that one doesn't exist. They all exist as separate universes. The Mary Martinverse, the Jason Marsdenverse, even the Julia Robertsverse. Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of others. I'm a huge Peter Pan fan, and that's how I got into Tinkerbell.
That's so good.
And I've created my own Pixie and Fae characters, and they're some of my all-time favorites. I'm in there too. I go by the name Jesse Schuchart, and Ariel is my significant other. I took Sir James Barrie's lore and, you know, expanded upon it, where the Fae born of your first laugh is not only a fairy. You know that a lot of people have turned that word into something awful. I hate that they've done that. The Fae that comes from your first laugh is actually your biological offspring with 97% of your DNA. So if someone says that they don't believe, it's their own Slavskorte giggle child that they kill.
Right. Wow.
Ooh, here's a good question. We were talking about Michael Bell, Virginia McSwain, Andrea Romano, Marsha Goodman, and the other voice directors. Michael Bell was the voice director for Fox's Peter Pan and the Pirates.
Yes.
What qualifications do they have? And what are the core responsibilities they're faced in that regard? I know that it could vary from project to project and franchise to franchise. There's got to be like core principles that they look
of a voice director.
Mm-hmm. Voice director.
Yeah. Well, I think some of the best voice directors have been actors, are actors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's funny. I was in England directing a show called My Secret Garden. And I directed Honor Blackman, who was Pussy Galore in the Goldfinger movie. And Sir Derek Jacobi and Victor Spinetti, and I mean, phenomenal Shakespearean actors. And I was doing everything in my power to relate to Derek how I wanted this one segment read. And he looks at me and he goes, "Susie, would you give me the reading?" And so I read it. And it was, you know, I said, "I'm not going to line read you, but oh, please go ahead, give it to me." And he got it like that. I don't believe in giving line readings. I know I've given a lot in my lifetime, but you know, if they can't get it in a few takes, sometimes it's easy for me to give the intention of it. I think I understand. I think a person who dialogue directs has to really understand and love the material that they're directing.
Mm-hmm.
I know sometimes there are directors who don't enjoy the material that they're having to direct.
Mm.
I think a voice director has to be a conduit to the actors from the producers and the writers who are sitting behind the voice director wanting to get their, the way that they interpret it, done. So I have to be a good conduit in describing that to the actors. I, you know, have never not liked an actor. I love actors. I love working with them. I think dialogue directors have to have great respect for actors and be incredibly familiar with the material
mm-hmm.
that they're directing, and let the actor play, let them have the time to play with the lines. That kind of, I know I could talk on and on about that, but that's my belief.
Hey, we're basically two peas in a pod then.
Good.
So one of the things I want to point out, you're in this episode, Forever's a Long Time Coming, both as Marissa Fairborn and as Beta.
Come! The Quins have more where he came from. We need all the help we can get. Though, you don't look like slaves.
Slaves? Who's a slave? We're not slaves. What makes you think we're slaves?
You wear the same brand we all do. The hated mark of our servitude to the Quins.
I thought in G.I. Joe the movie, Jennifer Darling, she sounded a lot like you when she played Pythona.
None may challenge Serpentor. This I command.
That won't be necessary.
Yeah, we do sound a lot alike. Other people have said that Jen and I have. You know, we basically have kind of that kind of sound. And she, you know, when she would play villainesses and things like that, she'd, you know, she would sound like that.
Also dorky girls in blue suits.
I guess this is as close as I'm ever going to get to having a romantic dinner for two.
Now, Irma, I'm sure one day you'll hear wedding bells.
Well, until then, I'll just have to settle for a microwave bell.
Yeah. Yeah, Jennifer Darling. She's a very talented woman.
I think they were all really awesome in Teenage Ninja Turtles. In Transformers the movie, what I learned from Michael Bell and John Machida was that during the Wally Burr sessions for that, it was one at a time, the voice actors. And Michael, he wanted to go in and see Orson Welles doing his lines.
Underestimate me, Galvatron. With time, consider spelling your wretched little planet Cybertron. Now you shall witness its dismemberment.
But unfortunately, Michael wasn't able to. And sadly, that was the last thing Orson Welles ever did.
Yeah. When I went in to do my lines, Judd Nelson was walking out. And of course, later, I was able to direct Judd Nelson in a Transformers.
Rodimus to the Leaf Guard Command. We are under attack. Repeat, requesting backup. We are under attack.
One of the last Transformers that I directed, actually. And Orson I got to meet him at a commercial. I was doing a commercial and he was coming out and I said, you know, you and I did Transformers together. Yes, I remember that, you know. But yes, usually when we did Jam and the Holograms and we did the TV series, we all worked together during that time.
Table read. To me, that would be the dream.
Yeah, that was fun.
You've worked with Maurice LaMarche a lot, right?
Yes.
So you can honestly say that he does sound like Orson Welles when he does his brain impression.
Yeah, he can do anybody. But yeah, he totally sounds like Orson Welles. It's interesting. Yeah, that's good.
I think the only reason I sound like Orson Welles
is because of the modulation that they had to do for his voice.
They did it pretty low. So.
They're so good.
You know, have you ever seen Dick Tracy, the movie?
Yeah.
It's a city of keys. I got a deal for you. Meet me at the city car park in 1 hour. That's right, 1 hour.
I honestly think that that was Edo Ross's voice because he was itchy in that movie.
Yeah, that could have been his voice.
Too bad I'll never find out because the one time I actually did talk to Ed, he was like, never call me again.
Really? Is that what he said?
Well, yeah, mainly because I looked him up in the white pages, which Greg Berger told me I shouldn't be doing, but because I had already, you know, friended Greg on Facebook and said that if he ever came back to St. Louis, I'd owe him the mother of all Emo's pizzas. That's why he gave me that chance. But Ed, I can understand why he would be irked by that. A stuttering guy he's never met. His phone number.
Well, at least you're energetic and, you know, you go after what you want.
Yeah, I'm sure that's how a lot of voice actors made their career, by, you know, putting their foot in that door in America.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Voice Overview will return after these messages.